About analog circuit design. Before we go to analog circuit design, we will look at what are the requirements that people generally have when they have an understanding of analog. In this material, I am using the material from a IIITD faculty in circuit design and research lab. This is course material from ECE 515. Why analog? All the world is an analog stage, and digital circuits play only bit parts. This used to be some people who said, but a very famous designer called Barry Gilbert, in his article which says, "Where do circuits come from?" said it is already there are people are designing CMOS VLSI without a lot of knowledge. And what happens is sometimes without much idea of the physics in the hardware, the broader sense doesn't make any effect. But when somebody people understand that, you're able to reach, Dr. Samuel Wilensky is an old analog guru. He said, in comparing analog and the digital disciplines, you can easily come across, do a lot of counting work that is. But an analog design requires an engineer to make intelligent trade-offs to optimize the circuit. Analog system is not black and white, but it is gray. It is this grayness which gives a lot of value to you. I will not talk about the first two points. Let me come to the third point where he again said in very important. Barry Gilbert says, some 30 years ago, I asserted at a seminar presented at UC Berkeley that the art of analog design demanded 30% attention to the signal path and 70% to biasing. This comment was met with total disbelief. However, after having taught this maxim widely and persistently during the intervening decades, I find no reason to change. So this is something important that I wanted you also to understand, that biasing is critical to a lot of things that you have going to be. Biasing affects your operation area. Biasing is going to affect what is the gain that you will get. Biasing will affect how much of current that will flow. Biasing affects how much noise can be tolerated. Bias can tell what is the amount of current control that you will have, where in the negative feedback you will get these. A lot of this is attributed to biasing. So, and most of the job sequence where you see typically regards to these points. Now, for example, when you are building advanced circuits like a SerDes or a CDR or a PLL, you will actually see that preliminary all of these are analog in nature. Though with technology scaling, CMOS is coming to place. But it is always needed, especially when you have in your wireless LAN area, ultra bandwidth technology, power management. This will be critical. You'll find that very simple concepts play a big role. And people who have attended the analog negative feedback area webinar would know that I spoke about two main points. One is gain insensitivity, and I've also sort of bandwidth extent. Now, if you look at these three areas called Wi-Fi, ultra wideband technology, and power management, you will find most of these topics contain either one or both these topics, so gain desensitivity and bandwidth extension. So bandwidth extension is more so in a wireless technology, and gain insensitivity will be probably on the power management side. So Jim Williams is one of the most popular design experts that you have. He is one of the persons who worked in building test circuits in linear technology. So the people who have heard of LTSpice, so LTSpice was linear technology developed spice simulator. Later it was acquired by Analog Devices, and they are right now the owners of the company. They have acquired it. But when he was there, he gave a very clear understanding of what is a description and what is the understanding. There are many times that you have to understand the design rather than describe it. A lot of the practical examples will show that you have to have an understanding of the design, whereas describing it would be simple as in a textbook example. So we will look at various facets. So where are the analog applications that you see? Anything that you can see with your eyes, feel with your skin, smell with your nose, everything is analog in nature. It does not have a digital connotation. whatever you feel, these are the real world signals. Real world signal is analog. Digital was introduced only to facilitate computation and not only facilitate computation, to allow faster computation and extremely high real-time operations to mimic the operation that happened in the brain. So only for the computer to understand what it is what you had digital equipment. Now, for example, if you see motion and acceleration is something that you commonly use, mechanical force, sound waves, electromagnetic field, temperature, sense organs, sensors and actuators, time, current, voltage, all these are analog. But you would see when you go inside a chip, you would see the digital system, which would be a digital communication, computer equipment, multimedia, control applications, etc. So what happens is you need a system which will be an interface to these two. And that is called the mixed signal electronics. Mixed signal electronics primarily controls understanding between converting the analog signals into a digital domain and the vice versa of the digital to analog. So when these two are done, you will be able to get the right kind of information. Now, what are the regular analog applications that you have come across in your daily life, either as a practicing engineer or a user? Central interfaces, which is my specialty, comes into pressure and temperature understanding, understanding acceleration, mass, having doing gas sensing and virus rate of expansion. I have been fortunate enough to design circuits for process, pressure, temperature, acceleration, gas and virus. Only mass I have not able been to do, which I'll probably do it in some time. Then there is going to be a biosystem. You understand how the biology works. Audio and video are the most common one. Currently, the Microsoft Teams facility that we use gives you the benefit of using audio and video. You're able to convert the audio that I'm speaking into a digital, get it transmitted across geographical locations and reach you. This is facilitated by a mixed signal electronics. Next is digital storage media. Digital storage media is also something that instead of transmission, it is basically storage. You take the analog interface, retain all the information along with you, keep it processed into a hard drive or a hard yardstick or a memory device, and then replay it at demand. Similarly, you have your USB, which also has a wireless USB, wired USB at various standards, which will have a read and write cycle, where you have a read memory and then you have to write into the memory. Two simple actions, but which is also all analog based. Every digital system that you are running right now at lower speeds is all digital. But when you want to make it run at really high speeds, you will need a analog portion, because analog is more faithfully able to reproduce the work and it has got a better performance metric as compared to a digital system. And RF in itself has got a lot of benefits. It is one of the most commonly used wireless transmission system, and you would see that it has got from low power range to very high power ranges, for example, in radars, radar radio receivers and radar radio transmitters, and also even for communication transmitters. For example, you have your transmit sequences for Doordarshan or your TV transport or your Wi-Fi or your direct to home sequences. All these have got these benefits. So after showing this, there are two approaches that are there. First is approach is analog circuit design. You understand what happens in the quantum mechanics, understand solid state physics, then the semiconductor physics, understand the device model, and then design the circuits. Another approach is treat the semiconductor device as a black box.